Isn't that awesome? Shout out to Juliana with the flying lemur halfway through there. That was a little scary. Today, Jesse will be sharing from Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 through 16. And so if you have your Bible, you're welcome to read along with me this morning. Paul writes, "As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. This is why it says, when he ascended on high, he took many captives and gave gifts to his people. What does he ascended mean, except that he also descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. So Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors and teachers to equip his people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of him who is the head, that is, Christ. From him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work." This is the word of the Lord.
Amen. When we stand to our feet, what a great video. Our kids were able to join that amazing camp. It's interesting to see everything in HD and slow motion. Growing up, you don't see those details, so that was kind of cool. So God is good, amen? All the time?
God is
good. Okay. God is good?
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
Okay, let's sing. 5, 6, 7, 8. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are. Worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are. You are good. Let's try from the top. Lord, you are good. Here we go. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. You are good all the time, all the time. You are good, you are good all the time.
all the time. You are good.
You are good.
You are good all the time. All the time. You are good. You are good all the time. All the time. You are good.
Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good. Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever. People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you.
Hallelujah, hallelujah,
we worship you.
Who you are,
who you are,
who you are,
who you are.
You are good.
You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
You are
worthy.
Your
praise.
I will follow.
I will follow.
I will listen.
I will listen.
I will love you.
I will love you.
All of my days.
All of my days.
I will see to and worship the King. I will love and adore him. I will bow down before him. I will seek to and worship the King who is worthy. I will love and adore him. I will bow down before him. You're my Prince of Peace. I will live by love for you. We're going to have a bit of choir practice. I'm going to break this down. I'm going to teach you guys chorus two. It's going to be for the ladies only. So sorry, guys. It's called the counter melody, okay? So we're going to sing the counter melody. It's going to be for the ladies. Guys, you can sing it the first time, but when we sing it for real, it's just going to be the ladies, okay? It's going to be a counter melody that goes with the chorus one at the same time. Ready? Five, six. We'll do it slower.
You are Lord of lords. You are King of kings. You are mighty God, Lord of everything. You're Emmanuel. You're the great I am. You're the Prince of Peace. Who is the Lamb? You're the living God. You're my saving grace. You will reign forever. You are ancient of days. You are Alpha Omega, beginning and end. You're my Savior,
Messiah,
Redeemer, and friend. You're my Prince of Peace. I will live my life for you.
Did you guys get that? Okay, so we're going to try the ladies on that part. And then the men will do the chorus. Let's see how this goes, okay? It's choir practice, okay? You guys remember choir? If you guys were ever in choir. Okay, ready? Five, six, seven.
I will sing to and worship
a King
who is worthy. I will love and adore him. I will bow down before him. I will sing to and worship the King who is worthy. I will love and adore him. I will bow down before him. You're my Prince of Peace. I will live my life for you.
Let's start from the top.
You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
worthy of praise.
Worthy of praise.
I will follow.
I will follow.
I will listen.
I will listen.
I will love you.
I will love you.
All of my days. Let's sing the chorus. I will sing. Here we go. I will sing to and worship. My life for you.
You're my Prince of Peace.
You're my Prince of Peace. I will live my life for you.
Yes, you will.
You're my Prince of Peace. I will live my life for you.
God, we thank you that you are a good God, you are holy, that through the trials, through the victories, that you are there. As we look into Ephesians 4 deeper, that the unity of Christ and the maturity that comes in a community, help us to continue to gather and to worship an audience of one. And for those of us who are struggling, those of us who are feeling defeated, discouraged, depressed, we pray and sing the song of victory, Lord, because we look to you. You are our hope. You are our source of power. You are our redeemer. We look to you this morning for breakthrough, for miracle signs and wonders. The word of God would pierce through our hearts. The Spirit of God would encourage and inspire us to move to action with faith.
Weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. My God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
Power in the mighty name of Jesus. Sing that as a prayer.
Power in the mighty name of Jesus. Every war he wages, he will win.
Yes, he will.
I'm not backing down from any giant, 'cause I know how this story ends. I know how the story ends. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
I'm gonna see a victory.
I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory.
I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. You take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant. You take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see the victory. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. We trust in you. Battle belongs to you, Lord. Oh.
Father, we thank you that the victory is yours and the battle is won. When we look to you, we can find hope. We can find joy. We can find love. Darkness will not prevail. Your word will prosper. No weapon formed against us will prosper. You are with us. You are for us. Who can be against us? We thank you. And all God's people say, amen. You may be seated.
All right, thank you, worship team. Thank you. Hello, everyone. How's everyone doing today? All right? That bad? Okay. For those who don't know, my name is Jesse. I am one of the elders here, and I wanted to start by saying how privileged I feel to be able to share the word with you all. It's been a few times that I've been able to share since Rob's sabbatical, and every time I do, I'm always struck by how different it is to be able to share to a congregation on a consistent basis, a congregation that I view as my own, and to be able to connect. I've been in a season before where I would preach in different places and I would engage in, you know, sporadically in different places. And I feel there's a very big difference in being able to share the word of God consistently with a group of people that I'm sharing a journey with and I'm getting to know, you know, slowly people here. And I think that matters. You know, I think that's why, like, just listening to a sermon online and engaging into the World Wide Web there, there's no context for what you're hearing. You know, the person who's sharing doesn't know the journey of a particular community. And so it might, trust me, there's a lot better preachers than what you're hearing going to hear today. But then it matters that it is part of the family and part of people that we can know. So doing online church and just getting the best goods that we can consume is different than actually hearing something from a particular person who perhaps you would connect with on a regular basis. And so that works vice versa for me in being able to communicate. And I just I'm just grateful to be able to do that with you all. We're going to be talking about Ephesians 4, 1 to 16, and I'll be just going through the passage as we go through that. But first, I want to paint you this picture for a moment. I want you to imagine that you are a peasant in the medieval period, okay? The medieval period where many people are peasants at that time. There's a great disparity between the rich and the poor. And you are there as a peasant trying to make a living. And you know what? In your position, and perhaps you're a woman peasant, you have very little agency. You have very little choices, right, of who you're going to marry. You have very little choices of what you're going to do in life. Guess what? Whatever your parents did, that's what you're going to do as well, right? If they worked the farm, which it probably was, doing crops or raising cattle, you're going to do that. So the idea of that season in life or that era was a time where there was no conception of autonomy or freedom in the way that we see it today, right? Today, we've naturalized this idea of autonomy. We've naturalized this feeling of like, I want to be who I was called to be, and I want my inner being of who Jesse is to be able to be manifest to give to this world. And I have so much choice of what I want to do when I grow up. You know, when I was younger, I was going to school, and I was just being able to choose for all the various things that could happen. And what I've really recently come to realize over the past few years is that that is an unimaginable new phenomenon in history. This idea of being able to determine who you want to be, when you want to be it, at any time's notice. Like, and we've just even in the past, you know, decade or a couple decades, we've experienced increasing autonomy, where before, you know, what you eat, for example, couldn't just simply be delivered to you by an app. Right? You couldn't go to Uber Eats and just like order from three different restaurants, three different orders that you want customized. You know, I want a particular drink, then I want a particular meal, and I'll get a dessert from over there. And you don't even have to move, you know? The autonomy of what to do now is like you are the master and everything else is at your disposal. And I think the interesting thing is that in this new era, this heightened individualism, what I would say, this desire to be who you are yourself, that every advertisement in there is to say, look inside yourself, be yourself, and find that identity. And once you do, that's the way that you're going to contribute to the world. And there's a beauty behind that, by the way, because back in, trust me, that peasant in the medieval period would crave and love to have this freedom to be who they are. They had to restrict themselves within a particular culture, within a particular tradition. And if they were to try to revolt against that, I mean, you can't. Like, you just get squashed and you would just be put aside. So actually, through the modern era, as time grew on, after the Enlightenment and we became more able to actualize ourselves, once that happened, we had an ability to be a little bit more authentic, that what your desires were inside could match what you did. Before, that wasn't the case. Even though you had great desires to do many things in the past, many things and many exploits, in the past, during those periods, you couldn't actualize them, right? You couldn't say, this is what I truly desire to do, and I will do it. Or, in tradition-wise, or in religion, you can say, no, I want to feel the love of Jesus. I want it to come out, and I want to do ministry out of a strong inner motivation. But during that period, it's like, no, you get baptized now. You don't have a choice. You just go and do it, because that's what tradition tells you. So the beauty of the modern era is that we were able to actually feel aligned with what we're doing. That's why throughout the Protestant Reformation and after that, we had this idea of like coming to Jesus in a way on our own terms, coming to Jesus with a desire from our hearts that like, I want to choose Jesus. I want to choose to be a follower of Christ. And there's a beauty behind that, because guess what? You can be able to have that agency to do so. But here's the issue. We've gone so far now to the place of individuality. We've come so far to a place where I do not want to be bound by tradition. I do not want to be bound by a collective identity. I want to be who I am, who I'm called to be. And guess what? I can live out that calling in whatever context. I can live that calling out in any congregation, in any body of believers. This body of believers here kind of isn't doing it for me. So I'm going to go to a different body of believers because that is what would actualize my calling in my personal identity. Now, this passage that we're about to read is an interesting one because it actually talks about calling. It actually talks about gifting. It talks about specializations, right? If you're a doctor, a lawyer, or if you're someone who's a teacher or someone, you know that you have a craft now, a specialization that you can offer the world. And in the scriptures and in ministry, we also can do our specialization in this particular text about being, you know, the gifting of evangelism or the gifting of being pastor. What we are called to do right now, what I want to suggest, is that in the beginning of this passage, it says, as a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. And when I hear that word calling, just to start with that first verse, the assumptions that I have is infused with all the way I see the world. In that my calling, the way I determined my calling when I was growing up is, what am I good at? Like, what is my contribution to the world? What am I good at? Because what I'm good at is what I'm called to do, right? And I remember one time some missionaries were sharing the data on how many resources go to unreached nations, you know, the hardest to reach places in the world. And as I heard that, it was like 1% of missionaries out of the 100, 1% actually go to unreached nations. Actually, missionaries tend to go to reached places most of the time. And I remember hearing the figures of how many dollars go to unreached nations, places that don't know Jesus. And I heard that disparity and I said, it's funny that we have created a culture of calling and what I'm called to do based on what we're good at, but not necessarily based on where the need is, right? The context of where it is. Because those statistics are mind-boggling. That if I'm only called to do what I'm doing, then it's actually void of looking at the context you are in and seeing, it doesn't matter if I'm good at this or that. This is a place that requires me to be there. Whether I need to be a janitor, whether I need to do something to serve the poor, it's not about necessarily calling in that moment. It's about the need that happens. If an urgent matter happened right now in our time, and there was a recession and we went into depression, and in here in Canada, our economy collapsed and all that, and we were in this kind of this kind of apocalyptic scene. In those moments, yes, it's good to have specialization, but guess what? You just have to do what you have to do to survive, right? That urgency calls us to actually have to do what we have to do. And when I see this passage over here, I'm struck by the fact that this idea of calling, first of all, Paul says that he starts with, says, as a prisoner, because he's actually a prisoner here, as a prisoner for the Lord, he indicates that he's a prisoner, meaning, like, I'm in a place right now in jail where I have to share to you about this idea of calling. That's a great place, by the way. It would be different if he was sitting, like, on a throne somewhere and saying, live your life to the calling. He says, he's in jail, and he says, live your life worthy of the calling. And then as he describes that idea of calling, he says, and he shifts gears, he says, be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the peace, the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. And I was struck by the idea that when we view calling in a very individualistic way, that I am called based on my individuality to do what I am best to do. It's funny how right away he transitions to the idea of being humble and gentle and being bearing with one another. And right away, if you see this text, because this text has a lot of the idea of calling and gifting, it right away is balanced with this idea of being in community. Like, humility and gentleness and bearing with one another. Like, if you say that I'm bearing with my wife, you know, I'm bearing to be with my wife, that doesn't sound nice, right? It doesn't sound like you're in a good place in your marriage if you're, like, just bearing with one another. But the idea and the reality is that community life will eventually come to a place where you have to come to conflicts and tension with people, where humility is demanded, where gentleness is demanded, where the idea of I gotta bear with you is going to happen. And when you situate calling, the idea of your specialization and what you contribute, and you put it into the context of a covenant community, not just a place that you would can subscribe to and unsubscribe to, but actually a covenant community where you bind yourself with people, guess what? That calling and that specialization mutates, and it kind of takes a new form because it has to be intertwined with a collective. Living out a calling on your own is much more easy. There's more agility. You can move left, right, center. You can go wherever you want. But when you live out your calling with people that you're joining with and intertwining with, that's more complicated, right? It slows you down in a way. Rather than this one, like this fast speeding boat, it slows you down to have to be with other people and kind of compromise and wait and see what they're going to do and what are their callings. And like, it's just long and cumbersome when you think about the idea of community. And so, in this situation over here, it's saying for us to bear with one another in love. Bearing with one another is indicating that there is a necessity for us to be a collective covenant community as we do that. So we've been talking about discipleship over the past little while before. And as we talk about discipleship, it's actually very easy to think of discipleship in a very individualistic manner. That I am going to do what I need to do to be formed spiritually. And me and Lucas have been going back and forth with this conversation lately, because he brought it up to my attention is that, you know, what's difficult right now with the idea of church and the idea of discipleship is that, as I mentioned in the beginning, like you have so much resources, you have so many things online that are feeding us, right? And forming us from various sources, many places, and they're good. They're great sources, and there's so much contribution that you can get from places. It's hard to get everything you can possibly get for your spiritual development all within one community. So, in a way, we pick from other places as well, and also not only resources or literature or like a Bible study that you can get from another place on another side of the world, but also your community. Some of us here have different spiritual communities in our life. Like you grew up in a church, perhaps in a context where you had a good friend that you could share your deepest, darkest secrets with, you can confess sins with. You have other different communities that you've engaged with that over time, guess what? When a crisis occurs, you will go to them, right? You might not go to someone here in church because you just got to know them and we're just trying to form an identity together. And this is the dilemma, is that what we've created, what we've naturally done in our modern era is we've created a fragmented discipleship. A fragmented discipleship where we get from here and there and everywhere in different places and we combine into it. But we're all going in a way our own discipleship paths as an individual. But there's what I'm learning lately is that although it might not be a streamed line, the idea of communal discipleship, the idea of working out your discipleship aligned with people on the same kind of literature, for example, or the scriptures, or walking with it, is actually a valuable thing because it allows the Word of God to actually interact not only inside of you and your internal growth, but guess what? The synergies that occur as you and another person in the church hearing the same things, trying to live out the same things, those synergies are also formative for us. Those synergies actually form us. The idea of being humble and gentle with one another, bearing with one another in love, those things are not hindering our discipleship. Those things are activating the discipleship to actually bring it to life. And I think that what we need to do is not only have a reactive type of discipleship. A reactive discipleship is this. A reactive discipleship is where we would go and engage with like a good thing that I heard over here, or a certain situation happens in our life and I feel like I need to confess my sins to someone. Guess what? If you live an individualistic life, you need a lot of motivation to actually say, okay, I'm going to call up my friend and I'm going to ask them to come and have a coffee and they don't know what's going on, but like, I just really need to get this off my chest. And then we come and sit down. I have to set the atmosphere where we just do our chit chat about the weather and all that kind of stuff. And I have to ease in getting to a deeper conversation about the fact, you know what? I want to share something with you. And this is kind of hard for me to say. And say, imagine the amount of work it takes to get from your motivation to confess a sin all the way to the point where you do it. And it's wonderful because you mean it from your heart. Like, it took a lot of time for you to get there. And so you really feel like you need to get this off your chest. But guess what? When you live in a community and a body of Christ, and there are rhythms and habits and traditions that we can have in this church. And sorry, if I can get some water. Looks like I've lost everything. Thanks. I think he's got it. When you have that, then you are able to actually have things in front of you. Oh, thank you. All right. Thank you for your... Thanks, Jeff. You are able to actually have things right there, patterns and habits that you can engage with, that you don't have to only conjure up yourself as an individual to do. But the community allows a structure for you to say, it's time to confess our sins to the Lord in this service. Let's do that together. And then we all come to the Lord and we do it. And I know it's like, well, you have to be prompted to do that. Why don't you just do it when you feel it? No, we are made to be in community. We are made to actually have rhythms in place where, you know what? It is easy for me to step into this time of confession, or it is easy for me to share this testimony before people. And so it's important for us to be in the context of a community to activate our discipleship. And I'll get more to that in a moment. Here we go. Okay, so from this text, I'm losing my voice as I speak. All right, but it says there that there is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all. And then here's the other transition in the text. It says, but to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. So he kind of ebbs back and forth. He starts with saying, you are called. You are called to live a life worthy. In a way, it feels very individualistic. It says, live up to your calling, your specialization. And then it goes into a communal say, well, you got to be humble and gentle with one another. Work it out in the community. And then he says, but, and he goes back and says, but, hey, when Jesus went up to heaven, when he went up, he actually granted the gifts to all people. So we are called actually to live out a particular gifting. And that particular gifting is to be lived out in our community. And he describes these giftings. I'm just going to skip straight to verse 11. So Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and the teachers. It's really going. Teachers to equip his people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining the whole measure of the fullness of God. Some of us have maybe heard this text before. Some refer to it as the fivefold ministry. It's the evangelist, the prophet, the apostle, the teacher, the pastor. All those fivefold ministries, we tend to see that, okay, those are the types of giftings that we need to live out. Are you an evangelist? Are you a pastor? Are you living that out in your life? And when we do that, what ends up happening is that we become the body of Christ because everyone is living out in their specialization. And so, it actually is interesting in this passage is that it says that the fivefold ministry exists, the pastor, the teacher, all these ones exist to do what? They exist to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. Now, this is very important because it's very easy in church to be able to rely upon the pastor and the teacher or the people who are gifted to do so, to do the work of the ministry. But that's not what the text says. The text says for those people to equip the saints, which is all of us here, the saints to do the work of the ministry, meaning that actually most of the work that is to be done in ministry is by the laity. That if you are actually like a really gifted church with a really gifted preacher and certain individuals, the 10% out of the 100% who are really gifted to do things, and you go ahead, guess what? That is not a mature body of Christ, not necessarily. That is a one type of church that has a few people gifted, But if the rest of the saints are not equipped to do the work of the ministry, then it's very different. So guess what? If you're really good in worship ministry, for example, your calling is not simply to be the best worship leader. Your calling is to equip other people for worship. If you are a teacher, if I'm here, my goal is not to be the best Jesse teacher or preacher out here. My goal is to equip many of you here to be able to share the word of God wherever you are and also in this church. It's much better to have many people who can preach the word of God in a church and have a mediocre preacher every Sunday than to have a star preacher on Sunday and a bunch of people who do not know how to exposit the scriptures, right? Actually, so it changes everything. It changes the way in which we see the gifting. The gifting is not for you to be the best you that you can be. The scriptures is saying that the best you is for you to equip the body of Christ so that what? This body is not a flimsy, fickle body that just goes by the whims or a better preacher somewhere else. We are a body that is going to be mature and sanctified and discipled because the people who are gifted chose sometimes to restrain themselves from taking the glory or all the time for the ministry and restrain themselves to say, I need to give more time for other people, even though it's not pretty, to actually manifest their gifting and develop it in their infant stages in discipleship so that their gifting can start to manifest slowly and that can take more of a step back. And then more people in the congregation can actually activate their calling of what they're supposed to do. And so actually this whole thing is that so that the body of Christ, so after equipping the saints for the work of the ministry, it says, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith. Isn't that interesting? Unity in the faith. Us activating our gifting in the context of a laity or the rest of the congregation and equipping the majority here to do the works of the ministry, what it does is it actually builds up the body for what? For unity. That was out of place for me because I thought it was about reaching people, right? I thought it was like this advancement of the church, of the kingdom of God and penetrating all of society. And maybe that is so, it is. But in this text is saying we are built up for what? The unity of the body. What is unity? Unity is actually us having more harmony in our church of aligning more people to start living the life of the church together, right? And so building up as the body is up so that it reach unity in the faith. Not just unity like we love each other and we care for each other, but unity in the faith. Meaning that the expression of our faith is unified. It's not a few people who really have faith, and the rest of us is like, they got a lot of faith. I'm glad I can join with them in their faith. No, that all of us are growing in our faith, in our discipleship, growing in our faith, that the unity comes when it's like, my faith is strong, and your faith is also strong. And it's not a situation in which it's like, my faith is strong, I'm good. Thank you very much. That's individualistic. I'm discipled. You know, I feel like very sanctified in the Lord. Great. No. If you have a communal sense of discipleship, you will realize that the goal is not only my own discipleship. It's the fact that I feel really good right now, and God is really working in me. And I look at someone else in the congregation, I'll be like, it looks like they're struggling in their faith. The goal here is to bring all of us in line. Let me just hold here for a moment. I feel like I'm good. Let me go to this person here and help them in their faith. Let's go together, because that's the goal. The goal is that all of our faith is that it's not your own individualistic faith. It's all of our faith. We need to look out for one another as we do this. And so, why? It says this in verse 14. There's so much more I can go into that. But then we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waters and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful schemes. Guess what? The answer to our ills of our society today, where everything on social media just pulls us this way and we don't know what truth is and we don't know where to find our grounding, the goal of the giftings in the church and the goal of discipleship in community is for us to hold hands together and actually not just be a holy huddle, but for us to simply say, how do we withstand all of the varied opinions in this world right now? We have so much information at our fingertips. It's hard to decipher. It's hard to discern as an individual. It's very hard to discern as an individual which way to go. Like there's arguments and there's points for all sides of the political spectrum from all these different religious denominational perspectives. There's so much there. And yes, you could just do an a la carte, like kind of pick and choose, you know, your own adventure from different denominations. Yeah, you could do that, and that's fine. That's part of the process of searching. And if you're in a university stage or if you're early, a lot of times, or if you're early in your faith, you will explore, and that's an important part as well. But as you do that, there needs to be a limiting of some sense of covenant community that can actually say, let's do this together. Let's have some sense. I know it's not perfect. Let's have some sense of cohesion. Let's have some sense of like moving together in a philosophy of ministry, a way of discipleship. Let's do some shape or form of that. Because as a group together, it's much harder to be tossed to and fro. And the fear for some of you is like, I don't want to be that peasant in the medieval period. You know, I don't want to just go with the groups, the like groupthink they call it, like where everyone says this and we're just going to go along with it. That's not what I'm suggesting. I'm not suggesting that we just go along back to a collective identity that simply is, you know, muting our own individuality. No, but now it's in time for us to know how to be an individual, how to grow as an individual, but know how it manifests together. Because I believe that in our day to day, it requires brothers and sisters in Christ budding together and being humble and gentle with one another to withstand the waves, like being tossed to and fro by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching, by the cunning and craftiness of people. We need to know how to stand firm together. You may be looking at this that I brought up. I'd like to say this was my kids who did it, but it's me. okay, so I was at this leaders conference of ministry, whatever, and then they had someone who's doing like a spiritual formation exercise. And there's a lot of like pastors and leaders and, you know, people there. And in my table, they gave everyone some clay. And they said, okay, let's take this clay and just start making something, like something that you feel like you got to give up to the Lord. Like, what is it? And I don't know what I was doing. I started making a little boat. And it wasn't this boat, but I made a little boat. And I was like, this is dumb. Like, why am we doing this? I'm like, I don't want to do this spiritual formation exercise. Just tell me. Just tell me. I don't want to do it. But I'm doing it. I'm like, okay, whatever. I'm doing the exercise. And then I made this little boat. And then I just felt, as I was doing it, is like, I started to see myself in my adolescence. And I saw myself as a young adult, kind of growing in my faith. And I remember those days were like pretty radical days where I was like really like tossed to and fro in a good way. Like I hear the wind of the Holy Spirit go this way, I'll go this way, I'll go that. I'm like ready and down for everything. And I was so like, I was like a speedboat back then. And this little boat that I was making kind of just was forming in my mind this idea of like the agility, the ability for me as an individual to go and do whatever I want and go far and fast as much as I want. And if there's a storm there, I'll go this way and I can avoid things and move as fast as I want. And then as I did that, I started building this other boat because I was like, but I have a family now. I have a family. And guess what? As a family man, I realized that, how did I process this? And I started processing the fact that, you know, as this individual, I got married. And in a covenant relationship with my wife, we have different paces, as I mentioned in one of my sermons before. We have different paces. We have different histories of ministry. And I have to know how to work with that. So I started crafting a new boat, in a way, in my life for my spiritual journey. And this new boat was bigger. it wasn't as sexy as this other boat. You know, it was a boat where two people have to be together, and we start moving in that. But then on weekends, I take my speedboat, right? I take my speedboat and, like, do ministry and, like, do everything I want. I go back home, I'm like, okay, I'm a husband. Like, I gotta slow down. And then I'd go back out, and I'd be going back and forth between this. And as time went on, guess what? They also gave us these little beads. Like, I started having kids, you know? And then these kids started, like, making me have to make a bigger boat. And this boat is getting slower. And this boat is, like, not necessary. It's like getting a van, like a van, you know what I mean? Like, it's like, I got my Honda Odyssey. Do we want that? No, but it's like, I wish we had nicer SUVs back when I was getting, anyways. But anyway, so I'm like, it's not as agile, it's not moving. And guess what? As I'm doing this exercise and I'm just working this out in my mind and building this big boat, it was actually one of these little beads that I took as one of the crafts. It was a small little bead that I was like representing my youngest son. And this small little bead, Benjamin, I was putting it into the boat, and then suddenly I just started crying. Like, I started like bawling, like in a table with other leaders where I mocked the exercise in the beginning with them. Now I'm like starting to be emotional. I'm like, because I can't get rid of that boat. That small little fast boat, I don't want to get rid of it. And it's like this feeling of like, I can't let go of this. I'm not saying this is for everyone to let go of your little boats or whatever, but or your fast car that you might have. I'm not saying that necessarily, but I started to see that like, this is actually pretty worth it, you know? This is worth it to actually go in this boat together as a family. And I know there's sometimes moments where I'll look at the things maybe I could do as an individual, and I'll look at this and I'm like, but man, there's a beauty behind this. It's kind of like me going this past couple of years, this exercise of feeling the beauty of what it is to go together with people. And it's a new formation of the ambition of my spiritual journey. It just kind of changed it. It didn't slow it down. I'm not saying it's slowing it down, but it changed the goals of what it means to grow spiritually as a family. And then, you know, we had to share it with people, and I'm trying to put it together, get rid of my tears as I'm talking, try to look like, you know, someone who's put together, and I bawled in front of this table of people I don't even know, and I'm sharing to them about a boat and this little bead, and they were supportive. And then we laid aside the small boat, and I use that analogy because I think it's instructive, not necessarily for people only with family, but in general, of what it is to walk with people. That when you walk with people and you join with others, it's bound, if you're in this church and you're like, this is a wonderful church, I love this church, say that after you get in a conflict with someone, you know what I mean, in the church. Say it after you weren't pleased with the sermon, you know, because that's when you really know you're a part of a church, where you actually go through something hard, and then you're like, I gotta work through this, I gotta bear with one another. You get to that point, then you can say, I love this. Like, this church is my church. It's only those times. And many of you who are new here, you will pass a romantic phase with the church at one point. And it's that moment in which the times get tough in community where there's disagreement. That's when you know this is my place. This is the covenant community that I want to do it. It's not only a meeting with Andrew. You know, it's a time where you actually get to know people that you don't necessarily click with. But you need to know how to work with them and be sanctified as a community. Because that's, guess what? Because it says this in verse 15. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become, in every respect, the mature body of him who is the head, that is Christ. Your goal is not necessarily only individual spiritual maturity. The task of this text is to say the mature body. Equipping the saints for the work of the ministry, that's the philosophy of equipping the body, not just the individual. And so when it says here, mature body of him who is the head, that is Christ, for him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. All today is about is reconceiving, having a reconception of the idea of spiritual maturity that is intertwined with your brothers and sisters. And if you have that as your premise, my question for you is, how does that change the way in which you want to be discipled? How does that change discipleship in the way you do things, of just having a fragmented best of everything I can get so that I can go as far as this? Or what compromises, what settling does needs to happen at times, not in a bad way, but a way of limiting and saying, you know, even though I could get better this and that there, our goal is to be mature together and to build one another up. And when that becomes the goal, the question for us that I want to linger here is, how does that change the way we do church? How does that change your decision about house church? How does that change your decision about attendance in church and all that stuff? Not to coerce you to do that, but it's to say, there's a benefit to that. Even though you may have someone who you're accountable with outside this church, that's good. Keep doing that. But there's something different than a reactive when I want to and a church that says, let's be in this together and let's set these relationships and let's commit to covenant relationship with one another and move together forward in that light. So that's the message today. Let's just pray as we close this time. If we can stand together and the worship team can come up. Lord, we just want to thank you, God, for, first of all, Lord, we thank you, God, for allowing us to be a body of Christ, of individuals, Lord, who, you know, it's not like a medieval period where we just have to do what we got to do, whether we want to or not. We have agency. We have a sense of, you know, freedom here, Lord, and we thank you so much for that, God. But, Lord, I pray, Father, right now, God, that in a, as opposed to the world, which just sees freedom and freedom itself as the ultimate aims and ultimate goals, Lord God, I pray, Lord, that we could actually grow to be a mature body of Christ who knows how to harness freedom, Father, as a body of Christ, to know how to harness it and be knit as one, Lord Jesus. And that as we do so, the world will know that we are your disciples because of our love for one another, God. And as we do that, we give and take, Lord, to one another here in this place as we look to our brothers and sisters who we know may be feeling cold in their spiritual life or having a hard time in crisis after crisis in their life. Lord, I pray, Father, that we would be a people, Lord, who can voice and be vulnerable about those struggles and to say, I need help, you know, to be able to grow in my faith. Anyone want? Any takers, Lord? Any takers? And also people here who are ready to say, I'm really, like, God's done a lot in my life and it's great. But I just, you know, look at my brothers and sisters and see how I can impart my life and continue to build one another up, Father. I pray that we can not only have a vertical view in our faith and our discipleship, but a horizontal one, God, that reaches out to those around us, Father. Let our, in a way, our maturity in our faith with you be so intertwined with the body of Christ, Lord Jesus, to some healthy kind of way that it is in our daily prayers, Father, to think about those in our church, Lord, in our life here, God. Yeah, we just surrender our pride to you. We surrender, Father, even our ambitions, God, and our specialties, Lord God. We surrender them to you and say, use us as you please, Lord God. You know, even though it might not be our expertise, Lord, let us serve as you would want us to in this community, Father, to build one another up, Lord. I pray a specific prayer for those, Lord, who are younger, God, and growing in their faith, Father, and adolescence and young adulthood, Lord. I pray, Father, that I feel like this is a message that is particularly difficult because of our culture's individuality. I pray, Father, Lord, the desire in our youth, Lord God, to desire community, Lord God, to desire covenant community that is rich and deep, Lord God, that is lasting. I pray that is cultivated in this church in the name of Jesus, Lord. Let us be a covenant community, one in you, mature in you, Lord. We thank you, God. In Jesus' name we pray.
What an important reminder, isn't it, church? It's in Ephesians 4, as Jesse was sharing, all these gifts of God, or not for our own, but to build the body of Christ, that the saints, the body of Christ, will be built up. This next song that we're going to sing as in response is written by a fellow by the name of Matt Redman, and he's from the UK, and he was doing some church planning with a guy by the name of Louis Giglio and Chris Tomlin. Some of you guys know them. And he was actually sitting in his empty house. His family had gone before him. They had done 2 years of ministry, doing amazing work for the Lord. And as he was standing in his empty home that had not sold yet, he was just looking in the room and picked up his guitar. And he wrote this song about the church coming together and maturing in Christ, and all the works that God had done, that even though he was alone in the room, even though the house wasn't sold, even though his family had gone before him, that in the times that, you know, life and church is not the way that we see it or want it to be, you know, as Jesse was saying, you will get hurt. You will grow to be annoyed, because we're not a perfect church and we don't claim to be. As a former pastor and marriage counselor, one thing that we taught my wife and I was pain in marriage is inevitable. Misery is optional. Pain is inevitable. And I think about the church, and pain is inevitable. But how we work together those differences, the conflicts with the gospel of Christ, is going to cause our relationships to grow deeper. So I just really want to share this song with you, that God is with you in the midst of the pain, in the midst of the loneliness, in the midst of trials, in the midst of the victories. And he is with you. He is here to heal our hearts, to grow up the body of Christ, to equip the saints for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up. Be encouraged. Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Stars and struggles on its way, but with joy our hearts can say, our hearts can say, never once did we ever walk alone, never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Kneeling on this battleground, kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts never stopped. Never once did we ever walk alone, carried by your constant grace, held within your perfect peace. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Every step we are breathing in your grace, evermore we'll be breathing out your praise. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Never once, never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Every step we are breathing out you, evermore we'll be breathing out your praise.
You are faithful, God, you are faithful. You are faithful. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. You are faithful. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. You are faithful. You are faithful, God, you are faithful.
Only a holy God.
only a holy God. Come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy, forever a holy God. Come and worship the holy God. Come and behold him. God, listen to that one more time. Come and behold and listen. Come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry and sing holy, forever a holy God. Come and worship the holy God. Come and worship the holy God.
As we close our service today, I want to thank Jesse again for leading us in that passage. And as we were considering what it means to be called together, to receive a calling from the Lord to be made into this mature body where we build one another up, I want to close our service by reading this benediction from Paul's first letter to the Thessalonians. He says, "Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." When Paul says "your" there, he's speaking to the plural. He's speaking to the body as a whole, not just to individuals. And he says this, he who calls you is faithful. He will surely do it. He who calls you is faithful. He will surely do it. And so we ask that this week you would go in the peace of God, knowing that he is faithful, that the calling he has given us as a body to be building one another up in maturity is one that he will faithfully bring to completion in us. As you go today, we also want to remind you that you're welcome to enjoy the beautiful backyard space that we have here. We did have a couple of tree branches on the north side, just on the left here, that had fallen. So we're going to encourage people, just for safety, to stay on the south side of the property until we have someone come in and take a look at those trees. And if you're a house church leader, please join us downstairs right after the service for our house church leaders meeting. Everyone else, thank you so much for coming. Go in peace. Thank you.